Hi everyone, welcome to a new lecture from the Mobile Chem Research Group. In a previous lecture we talked about umbrella sampling simulations, and today we are going to talk about another enhanced sampling method, which is called Replica Exchange Molecular Dynamics. As we discussed in a previous lecture, when we want to investigate a process which has a high energy barrier by molecular dynamics simulations, for example A to B, and if we start the simulation in the phase space of the reactant A, the simulation will be here in this region for a very long, long time, and the system will indeed never jump the barrier and populate the phase space of the product B. So what we need in order to simulate this reaction A to B is to use a more efficient sampling method able to accelerate the dynamics. Because what we want in order to investigate this mechanism is to populate the phase space of B and also to investigate the reaction pathway which connects A with B. So in this lecture, in replica exchange molecular dynamics, we are going to assume that we don't know the coordinates that drives the reaction. So in other words, we don't know the reaction coordinate. So, in general, in replica exchange molecular dynamics, we run several replicas of the system at different temperatures. For example, in this simplified picture, we are running here four simulations. So, one simulation at temperature Tm, which is the desired temperature we want to investigate. Then, a second simulation at higher temperature, the temperature Tn. Another one at To. And the last one at TP. Each of these simulations visit a particular configurational space, which we are going to call X. For example, the simulation which is run at temperature Tn is populating the configuration X beta. Okay, so we run the simulations for a particular time, these four simulations in an independent way, and after a particular time, we try to exchange a pair of replicas with adjacent temperature. For example, here we try to exchange the configuration delta and the configuration gamma in order that they run at different temperatures. For example, after the exchange, the configuration delta, which was running at the temperature P, will be running at temperature O, and the configuration gamma, which was running at the beginning at temperature TO, will be running later at temperature TP. We can also do the same for the other two replicas, and we have this result. Now, with this new situation, we run again the four independent simulations for a particular time, and after this particular time, we again try to exchange, for example, these two adjacent replicas. And after the exchange, we have now this situation. So if you pay attention, the configuration alpha, which was initially running at the temperature Tm, after these two exchanges, is now running at temperature To. Okay, so we can repeat this several times. And what we have at the end of the simulation is an interesting situation, because look here, we have a high energy configuration, because this configuration delta was generated at the beginning of the simulation when the temperature was very high. So here we have temperature TP at the beginning, and we have this high energy configuration. But after this exchange along the simulation, now this high energy configuration is running at the low temperature, so at the desired temperature. So we are populating high energy configurations. Okay, so let's have a look at the particular equations of the method. So the first thing we need to know is that not all the tries to exchange adjacent replicas can be accepted. For example, a very high energy configuration cannot populate a low temperature. Otherwise, we will have a very unrealistic situation. So we need some rules in order to accept or reject the exchange between two different replicas. Okay, so we will analyze this situation in more detail, but first we need to define a couple of things. For example, the first thing we will define is the probability of populating the configuration X alpha at the M temperature. So the probability of having this guy here, so the configuration alpha at M temperature. So this probability follows the Boltzmann distribution, and the Boltzmann distribution says that the probability of having such a situation is equal to the exponential of minus beta, where beta is the inverse of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by this particular temperature M. So beta multiplied by the energy of the configuration alpha, and this is divided by the partition function. We can also compute the joint probability of having all these configurations at these particular temperatures. For example, we are going to compute the probability of having the configuration alpha at the M temperature and the configuration beta at the N temperature, gamma at O temperature, and delta at P temperature. So this joint probability is just the product of the individual probabilities which are provided by the Boltzmann distribution. Okay, we also need to define the probability that the configuration alpha in the replica M is exchanged by the configuration beta in the replica N. So we want to exchange this configuration here at this temperature by this configuration here, which is running at this temperature N. So after the exchange, we get the following situation. Now we have alpha at the higher temperature and we have beta at the lower temperature. So we have exchanged here alpha by beta. Okay, so we are going to call W x alpha tm x beta tn to this probability. And also we can define the probability of exchanging the configuration beta in the N replica by the configuration alpha in the N replica. So in this case, let's say we are exchanging this guy here by this guy here, and we come back to the initial situation. Okay, so after having all these definitions in mind, we can proceed with the equations. So, for a system which is in thermal equilibrium, as it is our case, the detailed balance condition holds. And that means that the probability of having this situation, which is this guy here, so this is the probability of having this configuration at this configuration at this temperature, and so on, multiplied by this probability. And this probability, remember, is the probability of exchanging these two guys here, the configuration alpha by the configuration beta. So this product is equal to the product of the joint probability of having this situation. So in this situation, we have here the alpha configuration at the high temperature and the beta configuration at the low temperature. So this term here, multiplied by the probability of exchanging this guy by this guy. Okay? So this is what is called the balance condition. And in that case, since we are a system in thermal equilibrium, this equation is satisfied. Okay? So let's organize a bit this equation. So we have these two probabilities together on the left part of the equation, and these two probabilities together on the right hand of the equation. Now, if we substitute equation 2 into this equation 4, and remember that equation 2 is this equation here, the joint probability is just the product of the individual probabilities, we get equation number 5 here, where we have on the right side the individual probabilities. Now, this probability O and this probability P is the same here and here. Therefore, they cancel out and we get equation 6. And Now we substitute equation 1 into equation 6, and if you remember, the equation 1 is just the Boltzmann distribution. After doing the substitution, we get equation 7, and now the partition functions here and here cancel out, and also the exponentials, which are here with a negative exponent, can go upstairs with a positive exponent. Okay, finally, we arrange a bit here the exponentials, and we have that the probability of having the exchange is equal to the exponential of minus the difference between these two betas multiplied by the energy difference between the configuration beta and the configuration alpha. So we are going to call this exponent delta in order to simplify the situation. So this is the main equation we need to analyze in order to know when a exchange between replicas is accepted or not. Okay, so in order to accept or reject a exchange, we are going to use the Metropolis criteria. And this criteria says that the probability of accepting the exchange is equal to 1, so it's 100%, when delta is lower or equal than 0. And the probability of accepting the exchange is equal to the exponential of minus delta, where delta is this guy here, when delta is positive. Okay, so that means the following. When this change is accepted, so if we look at this equation, the equation 11, when the probability of accepting the change is equal to 1, this happens only when delta is lower than 0. So let's analyze delta. In delta, we have here the beta m minus beta n, which is, as you know, the inverse of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature. So we have here Tm and Tn. So remember that Tm is a low temperature. So it is here. This is the lowest temperature. So that means that this is large. And now Tn is a higher temperature. So that means this term is smaller. So we have something large minus something small, so this is positive. So in equation 10, this is positive. So in order to have here delta negative, we need to have this energy difference negative. So, and the energy of the configuration beta minus the energy of the configuration alpha is negative only if the energy of beta is lower than the energy of alpha. So this energy here, the energy of this guy, has to be smaller than the energy of this guy. So in other words, exchange between replicas is accepted when the energy of the high temperature configuration, which is beta here, is smaller than the energy of the low temperature configuration, which is alpha. In this situation, the exchange is accepted always. Okay, so let's analyze the physical meaning of this situation. So we are going to represent here the probability distribution of the energy of the different simulations. So for example, this is the probability distribution of the energy of the simulation which is run at the temperature Tm, for example. Now, this is the probability distribution at the higher temperature N. This is the probability distribution at the higher temperature O, and so on. So when we increase the temperature, of course, the energy also increases. This is why the probability distributions are shifted to the right. Okay, so we are saying that the exchange is accepted when the energy of the configuration beta is smaller than the energy of the configuration alpha. So that means we are in this region here, because in this region is where the green curve has lower energies than the energies of the blue curve. So that means that we need that the potential energy distributions of adjacent replicas overlap, because only when we have overlap we will have a situation where the energy of the configuration beta is smaller than the energy of the configuration alpha, and then the configurations can be exchanged. This is a problem when we are running large systems because the overlap becomes smaller with the system size, as we are going to see in the following slides. So let's analyze the situation with a biological system, for example, a protein that is called, in this example, P, in water solution, which is called W. Okay, so the energy of the system is just the sum of the energy of the protein, the energy of water, plus the interaction between protein and water. So that's the total potential energy. And these two terms are the problematic terms when we are talking about overlap of the distribution functions, because the energy of water and the interaction energy between the protein and the water depends on a very large number of molecules, because they depend on the number of water molecules. Or in other words, these terms depend on very large number of degrees of freedom. And that means if we increase the temperature in order to run the different replicas, we are increasing a lot the energy of the system because we have a very large number of degrees of freedom. So the energy of water and the interaction energy between protein and water is increasing a lot. So because of this, we have the following situation. We have the probability distributions of the four replicas, which are very well separated, and we don't have overlap. And this is bad because, as we have seen, we need overlap in order to accept the exchange between adjacent replicas. So what we have to do is to run additional simulations. So we have to run a lot of replicas in order to get a good overlap between the probability distributions of the energy. And this is computationally demanding because we have to run many, many simulations. So when will we have a good overlap between neighboring distributions? So for example, if this is the average energy of the distribution run in the replica M, and this is the average energy of the distribution N. So we can also compute the broadness of the distribution of the replica M. So we will have a good overlap when the broadness of the distribution is more or less similar to the energy difference between the average energy of consecutive replicas. And indeed, it can be shown here in this paper, they have shown that the number of replicas needed to have a good overlap scales with the root square of the number of degrees of freedom. So if we have a very large system with a high number of atoms, the number of replicas we have to run is very high. A way to avoid this large scaling with the number of atoms is to modify the Hamiltonian and run what is called Hamiltonian replica exchange molecular dynamics. So far, we have seen that in a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics, we run different replicas of our system at different temperatures. And then our Boltzmann distribution for each of the replicas depends on a particular temperature, which is here inside in this beta parameter, which, remember, is the inverse of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature. In Hamiltonian replica exchange, we have a similar situation, but now we are running the different replicas using different Hamiltonians. So now in our Boltzmann distribution, we have here in the energy the subindex M, because for each of the replicas, we have a different energy, so we have a different Hamiltonian. In the following slides, we are going to see two common approximations which use different Hamiltonians to run the simulations. So, before going in detail into these two methods, we need to again define a couple of concepts. So, we can define the probability of exchanging the configuration alpha in the M replica by the configuration beta in the N replica. So again, we are doing the exchange between these two simulations, alpha and beta here. So again, we are going to call this probability with the letter W. Also, we can have the probability of exchanging the configuration beta in the M replica by the configuration alpha running in the N replica. So when we do this, we come back to the original situation, right? Okay, if we apply the balance condition that we have used in the previous slides, we can see that the ratio of these two probabilities is equal to the exponential of minus delta, where delta is the energy of the configuration beta in the Hamiltonian M plus the energy of the configuration alpha in the Hamiltonian N, so that is, this is the final situation after exchange, minus the energy of the initial situation before exchange. If we look at this part of the equation, we have here the configuration alpha running in the Hamiltonian M, which is here this guy, so this is our initial situation. And here we have the configuration beta running with the Hamiltonian N, which is this guy here. Okay, so the first term of equation 17 is the situation after exchange, and the second term is the situation before exchange. So again, the probability of having this exchange is equal to 1 only when delta is lower than 0, and this happens only when the energy of the final situation, so the situation after exchange, is lower than the energy of the situation before the exchange. However, if delta is lower than, is larger than 0, then we accept the exchange with a probability equal to the Boltzmann factor, as we have seen before. So this is the Metropolis criterion. Okay, so now let's have a look at the two approximations which use this Hamiltonian replica exchange. The first approximation is called a replica exchange with solute tempering 1 or REST1. So in this situation, the Hamiltonian is modified in a way that the solvent is cooled. So for example, let's say we have a protein that is called P in water solution that is called W. So in, let's say in normal, in a normal situation, the total energy of the system would be the energy of the protein plus the energy of water plus the interaction energy between protein and water. But now in this REST1 method, we are scaling the energy of water by this factor here, and also we scale the interaction energy between the protein and water by this factor. And beta zero is the inverse of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the target temperature. So this is the temperature we want to analyze at the end of our simulations. And beta M is the Boltzmann constant multiplied by a higher temperature than the target one. Okay, so that means, as I said, the temperature M is larger than the temperature zero, so than the target temperature, and that means that beta M is smaller than beta zero. If beta M is smaller than beta zero, then these two coefficients here, which are multiplying these two energy terms, are larger than one. So in other words, the interaction between solvent molecules are higher than usual, and the interaction between the protein and the water molecules are also higher than usual. So that means if the interactions are higher, this is like an analogous situation as cooling down the system. Because if you cool the system, the motion of the atoms is slower, and then the interaction is stronger. For example, if our target temperature is 300 Kelvin and the higher temperature is 600 Kelvin, equation 20 becomes equation 21, where we are scaling the interactions between water molecules by 2 and the interaction between the protein and the water molecules by 1.5. So as I said, the interactions are stronger, or in other words, our solvent is stiffer because we are cooling the solvent. Okay, so again, we have here our equation 20, which is the total energy with these two factors scaling the energies of water and interaction between protein and water. And now, if we apply again the balance condition that we have used in the previous slide, we can get equation 23, where we can compute this delta factor. Remember, this delta factor determines the probability of accepting the exchange between these two guys. Okay. And here in this equation, we have the energy of the beta configuration when it is running in the replica M, but this is the energy only of the protein. So this EPM means the energy of the protein with the Hamiltonian M when the protein is in the beta configuration. This term is the interaction energy between protein and water when we are using the Hamiltonian M and when the system is in the beta configuration. Okay. Here we have energy of the protein with the Hamiltonian N when the system is in the alpha configuration. And finally, interaction energy between protein and water using Hamiltonian N when the system is in the alpha configuration. So this equation gives the probability of exchanging these two replicas here, okay, the replica N and the replica M. Okay, so if you look at this equation, the term which describes the energy of the water molecules, so the interaction energy between water molecules, doesn't appear in this equation 23. And also, the interaction energy between the protein and the water molecules is scaled by 1/2. So that means the poor scaling with the system size now is alleviated, because if you remember, in a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics, delta was equal to this equation 10. And in this equation, we have the energy of the configuration beta and the energy of the configuration alpha. And these energies are the total energy, where the total energy depends, of course, on the energy of the water solvent. So here, if we increase the number of water molecules, the total energy scales a lot, and also the delta scales a lot with the number of degrees of freedom. And this was the reason in a standard replica exchange why the neighboring probability distributions don't overlap. So here now in this new method, in the REST1 method, we are somehow solving the problem because we are eliminating this term. We are eliminating the energy of the water molecules from the equation, and also we are scaling by 1/2 the interaction energy between the protein and the water molecules. So, for example, in this paper, they have run molecular dynamic simulations for the alanine dipeptide in more than 500 water molecules. And this is what they found. So when they run a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics, they have to run this very large number of replicas in order to have a good overlap between consecutive probability distributions. Okay, here you can see highlighted the replica run at 300 Kelvin, 417 Kelvin, and 603 Kelvin. However, when they run a replica exchange with solute tempering, so this guy here, at these three temperatures, they only need to run indeed these three replicas in order to have a good overlap between the probability distributions. Okay. And here we don't need to explain this in detail, but this is just the configurational space of the protein, where these two plots represent the sampling of the standard replica exchange, and here you can see the sampling of the REST1 simulations. And what you can see is that the sampling is very similar, but the difference is here we are using a very large number of replicas, and here we are only using three replicas. However, we get very similar sampling. So here, when you run a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics, you need 22 replicas in order to get similar sampling than REST1 using only three replicas. Okay, now let's have a look at the last method, which is called replica exchange with solute tempering 2, which is very similar to the previous one. So this method was developed because it was found that REST1 sometimes is less efficient than a standard replica exchange, especially for systems which has very large energy differences between conformations. They have shown this situation in this paper. So, in this REST2 method, they have also modified the Hamiltonian in the following way. So now they multiply the energy of the protein by this factor. The energy of water is not changed, and the interaction energy between protein and water is also scaled by this factor. Okay, so this equation is, let's say, analogous to saying that the protein is being heated, because remember, the temperature M is larger than the temperature zero, than the target temperature. So that means beta M is smaller than beta zero. And then this coefficient here is smaller than one. Okay, this coefficient here is smaller than one. So that means that the interaction energy between the atoms of the protein is smaller than usual. If the interactions are smaller, if the interactions are weaker, this is the same as saying that we are heating the system, because higher the temperature, smaller the interactions, right? In the limit of infinite temperature, there is no interactions in our system, right? Okay, so in this method, we are not cooling the solvent as we did before. Remember that in REST1, we are here multiplying the energy of water molecules by this factor, and this factor, remember, was larger than one, which was the same as saying that the water molecules are being cooling, right? Because interactions are stronger. Okay, so in REST2, the protein is heated, in REST1, water is cooled. If we apply now the balance condition as we did before, so we get that the probability of exchanging these two guys, as usual, is equal to the exponential of minus delta. And now delta follows equation 26, where we have the energy of the protein when we use the Hamiltonian M and the configuration of the system is X beta, the interaction energy between protein and water with the Hamiltonian M and when the configuration is again beta, minus the same term, but now we have the Hamiltonian N, and the configuration of the system is X alpha. Okay, so in this equation, delta scales is lower with the system size than in REST1 because of this coefficient here, which is multiplying the interaction energy between protein and water. So let's analyze this in more detail by comparing equation of REST2 with equation of REST1, which is this equation 23. If you remember, so the first thing we have to notice is in both equations, the term which describes the energy of the water molecules doesn't appear. And this is good because then the scaling with the system size is slower in both situations. But now let's compare this coefficient here with this coefficient here. So in the equation of the REST1 method, the interaction energy between the protein and the water molecules is scaled by 1/2. However, now in REST2, this interaction energy is scaled by this coefficient. And this coefficient is usually smaller than 1/2. So that means the interaction energy here is smaller, and the scaling of delta with the number of degrees of freedom is therefore also smaller. This is why the overlap between replicas is usually better for the REST2 method, which means that the sampling is much better than for the REST1 method. In summary, in replica exchange molecular dynamics, we have several replicas of the system simulated at different temperatures. Then, exchange between replicas are allowed when good overlap exists between consecutive simulations. Because of this, we have high energy configurations running at low temperature, and this is a good situation because then we are exploring a large region of the potential energy surface, or in other words, we have a very good sampling. One problem of the method is that the overlap between replicas becomes poor with the system size. That means when we add solvent molecules, for example, in our system, the overlap becomes usually very, very bad. One way to overcome such a situation is to modify the Hamiltonian, and then we are running Hamiltonian replica exchange molecular dynamics. In particular, two popular methods are the REST1 and the REST2 methods, where we are cooling the solvent in the first situation and heating the protein in the second approximation. That's it. Thank you very much for watching and see you in the next lecture.